Welcome to another episode. This is me on Instagram. I hope you're following. I have a really fun guest on the show tonight who is just winning things left and right these days. And if you want to win things, well, I won't say Epic Roll will guarantee you a win, but it's definitely a step in the right direction. Whether you're competing every weekend or you're training once a week, you need the best without having to spend the most. That's Epic Roll. Epic Roll gear is gear designed by grapplers for grapplers. Plus, you can take 15% off your order at epicrollbjj.com with the code podcast15. Gis, fight shorts, rash guards, t-shirts, belts, hoodies, anything you can need on or off the mat, Epic Roll has it for you. Make sure you're following them on Instagram at epicrollbjj and use the code podcast15 to get 15% off your order at epicrollbjj.com. My guest today is a Jiu Jitsu brown belt and pro competitor who just won the EBI Rules Medusa event and also just set the record for fastest women's submission in Who's Number One history. Please welcome to the show, Sophia Cassella. Thank you for so much for coming on. And you are actually one of the few people who actually comes early to the meetings, which never happens. So you're immediately like in the top five guests ever.
Awesome. Thanks for having me. I'm excited.
Yeah, I really wanted to have you on because you've been doing so much recently and winning so much. I wanted to grab you before you realized that you were much too cool to be on this show. So I appreciate you coming on for a little bit.
Thank you. Thanks.
It has been a busy like 6 weeks for you with Medusa and ADCC and Who's Number One. So are you like taking a break for a little bit to catch your breath, or are you still in the middle of a stretch?
Yeah, I definitely need to take a break just because like it's just like a lot of traveling, and it's like it's definitely taking a toll on like my grades and my schoolwork. And then like also like I was traveling every weekend. So like when I would come home between competitions, I'd only have like 1 or 2 days of training to prepare for the next one. So then it was like, okay, I'm not really getting any training in, and I'm not really working on anything or improving my skills. So I definitely like think I need like a 2 month break to just work on my mistakes and finish up the semester. It ends next month. So I won't be back on the competition scene till like June, I think.
And I do want to ask you about, you know, all of those events and everything you've done, but just for a little bit of backstory, and the easy first question I always ask everyone is just, how did you get started in jiu-jitsu?
So I was a competitive figure skater. Yeah, I have a brother, and he was not really into like any like traditional school sports. Like he didn't want to play soccer. He didn't want to do football. He didn't want to do baseball. Like, so my, dad eventually signed him up for a martial arts program, and we were with our dad that day, like cause my parents are separated. So like I was with him when he went to his free trial class, and the instructor invited me on the mat as well. And I just fell in love with the free trial class. I had so much fun. And I eventually ended up signing up for that and quitting figure skating altogether.
Oh, wow. Then, so that's a big move from like one sport you're pretty dedicated to just like leave it behind.
Yeah, and go right like, to bye.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then, so that was like martial arts though. That wasn't really jiu-jitsu, but then the instructor of that gym went and opened their own gym. And then that was a jiu-jitsu school. So that's when I started training jiu-jitsu. I was like 12 and a half.
Oh, wow. So how did you go from just training to taking on this competitive lifestyle and competing so much? Was it pretty smooth, or did something change where you were like, okay, now I'm attacking this?
I mean, it was pretty immediate. My coach, my first ever coach, actually forced me to compete, even though I hated it. She just kept putting me out there. And I honestly hated it until I got my first double gold at like an NJBJJF, which is like a local tournament. It's super small in New Jersey. But I got my first double gold there, I think. And then I was like, okay, I like this.
Yeah, this is pretty cool. I could do this.
This is cool. I could get used to this. Yeah.
And then you went, I mean, you, like I said in the intro before you hopped on, you've done so many big events. Was Medusa for EBI, was that really the first time that you were like, oh my God, I just won like this huge big thing? Like, what was that experience like?
I mean, it was super exciting. I feel like, I don't know if it's the first time I ever won something big. It kind of depends on like what you're comparing it to. Cause I've won on other big tournaments. Like I won like Pan Ams and stuff.
Yeah.
And I feel like the first time I ever felt like I won something big was when I won the finishers the month before. Cause yeah, that to me, like I had beaten someone who's top 10 and then I got ranked and it was just like super exciting. But being on the Medusa stage, it definitely felt a little more overwhelming just because it was like, it was very professional and there was like lights and music and promos and, it was in Cancun and like, it was on UFC Fight Pass and it was just like, it was very overwhelming. Like I remember before my first match, like I felt like I had a huge lump in my throat and I was so nervous and I was like shaking and I was, it was crazy. Like I've never been so nervous before a match in my life.
Well, it's like a different level where there's like a production value and it's a show, not just you're here to compete in this tournament. But
yeah,
I mean, you didn't look super nervous. Did some of that shake off once you got out there and you started competing, or were you that nervous the whole night?
Actually, I was pretty nervous after my first match because it was a really like tough match and I won by riot time and overtime. But then after I like won my second match in like 20 seconds and I was like, oh, okay, I feel great.
Yeah,
I have like an adrenaline dump after my first match and I was like physically shaking from exhaustion and I had like probably a 30 or 40 minute break, so I was like, why am I still shaking from exhaustion? Like, what is wrong with me? Like, I was freaking out. And then after my second match I got like my adrenaline back because I won it so fast. I was like, okay, now I feel great, I'm ready to go, I'm ready for the finals.
Yeah, that's a pretty terrible feeling when you're like feeling drained and you know you still have more matches to come. So I'm sure going from feeling drained to like a 20-second win was probably a pretty welcome change to get a little more time to catch your breath back.
Yeah, it like saved the whole night.
Have you been approached about doing more of the women's only big show productions? Is there anything like that in the works?
I mean, I've done other women's only shows. Like there's a show called Subs on the Shore and they do all women's events. It's not as like high profile as Medusa. I definitely expect to be back on Medusa soon to defend my title, but otherwise
You got
to
defend it. You're the reigning champ. You got to defend it.
Yeah. But like nothing like women's only. I don't have anything like women's only events like coming up.
You included. There are like some killer female grapplers right now that are putting on really, really good matches. Have you cross-trained with any of the other big name girls like Grace Gundrum or Danielle Kelly, who are sort of in this New Jersey, Pennsylvania area at all?
I actually haven't.
No?
I don't know how I'd feel about like cross-training with someone else who's like also top 10 in my division, because I want to compete against them.
Right.
And I have like a lot of high level girls that I train with already. Like I train with like girls that are like high level in the UFC. Like I train with my friend Jaden, who's ranked at 145. I have a lot of really good girls that I train with. So I feel like I don't need to like get training in with like the other girls in my division that are top 10. You know what I'm saying?
Right. For sure. You want to also have a little bit of surprise for them when you end up competing with them, as opposed to having been on the mat with them previously. But you train under Tom DeBlass, correct?
And also Jason Rao. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, so you basically have a two-headed monster of really amazing jiu-jitsu in your corner.
Yeah. Yes.
You're in Jersey for school too, right?
Yeah, I go to Montclair State.
What's it like balancing that sort of course load of being a full-time student and also like a high level competitor in jiu-jitsu? How do you balance that?
I mean, it's definitely super annoying, but it's nothing like too crazy. As long as I can train every day, like I only train once a day. As long as I can train every day, like I'm okay. It's just like annoying having to like, now that school is back to being in person, having to like drive back and forth between training and school and work and just in the gym and everything, especially because like the gyms that I train at, like jiu-jitsu, are so far away from where I live. So it's just like everything is just time management and really trying not to be like leaving on time, like being very strict on my schedule, like everything's by the minute. It's not even hard. It's just like frustrating and like requires a lot of like time management. It's nothing too crazy. Like the workload isn't too crazy.
I'm not in the elite competitor category of jiu-jitsu, and I couldn't manage like family, school, and jiu-jitsu all at once. So I don't know how you do it, but you seem to be doing okay with it. Because after you did the Medusa, you just decided to go out and set the record for the fastest submission in a female match at who's number one. Like, you're just like, oh, on a whim, I'll just go out and short notice and take a record. How does that happen?
I mean... I was already in Texas for Subs on the Shore. I did their 125-pound ADCC rules, like, eight-girl bracket. And I was, like, literally at the event. And then I got a text message from Michael Sears asking me to fill in for Tammy because she needed to pull out. And I was like, yeah, okay. I'm already in Texas. I might as well just stay here for the week, right?
Why not?
Yeah, so I just, like, emailed all my teachers and told them I wasn't coming in. And most of them answered me and they were like, okay, good luck. Just keep up with this coursework and you'll be good. See you next week. And it was fine. Everything ended up working out fine.
Yeah. That's another big stage though. That's another like production event on flow grappling. And you go out and you hit the fastest submission of all time in women's matches. Have you noticed since you had these higher profile Medusa and then who's number one, have you noticed more attention on you, or is it sort of just in the background and you're just going about your life training and going to school?
I feel like there's a little bit more attention on me just because like my Instagram blew up and then I got asked to do a bunch of podcasts and I had people asking me like for seminars and stuff, but that was like within the first week of me winning these things. I feel like now that it's been like almost a week since the last time I competed, it's been like 2 weeks since who's number one, I feel like things are starting to calm down and go back to normal again.
It's not going to stay that way because you're going to compete one more time and it's going to ratchet back up. And then I'll be sliding in your DMs again, trying to get you to come back on the show to talk to me about the next thing that you won. You just went out and you did the ADCC trials. Was that the first time you've competed at the trials?
It was actually the third.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. You're 21 years old. You've done ADCC trials three times.
Yeah.
Okay.
I did the first one like right after I turned 18. So.
Wow. All right. Well, now I feel even worse about myself having never competed at ADCC trials. You've done it three times already. Your match with Amanda Bruce, you guys went to overtime. Amanda Bruce is like, she's a killer. She's really good.
She's really good.
I think she also, because you usually compete at like 115, right? I think she usually competes a little bit heavier than you.
Yeah, I think that she competes at 125 most of the time. So she's got like a pretty decent size advantage on me. I don't know if she walks around at 125 or a little bit heavier, but she's definitely a little bigger.
Yeah, I mean, that's a tough first round match against someone who's very, very good and Amanda Bruce, who's also bigger than you. But you guys, I thought you had a good match where you went to overtime, and it's just, I think it's frustrating when I'm a sub only guy. I'd prefer to watch every ADCC match be sub only because I don't like points, and it's just, I think, a truer form of jiu-jitsu. But I would have preferred to see like maybe 10 more minutes of that match. I don't know if you would feel the same way as a person who is in the match, but
I mean, I definitely prefer sub only also. I think that like historically, like people in the Henzo Gracie affiliation are not the best when it comes to points tournaments. Like we tend to do better in sub only. I definitely fall in that stereotype, I guess. I feel like I did a pretty good job of like not getting scored on in regulation, even though I was getting kind of like dominated. And then like by the time like the overtime came, like it's like all of my knowledge of the rules just went out the window. I don't know.
Yeah.
I would love to have a match with her again at some point. Whatever rule set, I think it would be a really good learning experience for me. I would have loved to have also kept going because like another 10 minutes of the match would have been like fun. I think that it was a good match.
I love ADCC and I do think it's one of the better rule sets in competitive grappling. But like you said, there are a lot of nuances to the rules and there are a lot of ways that you can sort of game the rules. And I'm not saying that's what Amanda Bruce was doing, but I think any rule set that isn't, all right, who's going to get tapped first? It's too many rules in a jiu-jitsu match. Like, let's just go out there and do sub only. But I also understand why you can't do that for ADCC when you have like a thousand competitors trying to compete all on one weekend.
Yeah.
So I know you had said that you were sort of in a break from competing. Do you have things scheduled and it's just far away, or are you just sort of waiting to see how things shake out?
I don't have things like scheduled, like set dates, but I definitely have a couple things in mind for June and then for like the end of the summer. Like I've had a couple promoters like hit me up and they're like, we wanted to do this match. And I was like, I'm taking like a couple months off. Like I'm gonna like finish school and I'm gonna go on like a mini vacation / training camp in Costa Rica. And then I'm gonna come home and then I'm gonna start prepping for tournaments. I mean, I'm gonna be prepping for tournaments anyway, cause I'm gonna be training, but like, I'll start like actually prepping for tournaments. So I have like a couple things in mind for like the summer, just nothing like no set dates, nothing set in stone yet.
Now, what's the difference like for you when you're in, like, I'm prepping for tournament mode versus like right now when you're sort of trying to juggle? What does your training schedule sort of look like when you go for, all right, it's time to get ready in tournament mode?
So the training schedule stays the same. I still train the same amount, but I definitely cater my jiu-jitsu to the rule set. So like if it's an EBI rules tournament, I'm doing EBI overtime every day. Top and bottom armbar, top and bottom back. And then I'm also like, my jiu-jitsu is going to be more like, looking for submissions from everywhere. Cause that's the only way you can win. Like if I'm rolling with one of my training partners and we're wrestling and then I get taken down and then I sweep them and then I'm on top and I'm just like on top the whole time and I don't get any submissions, and that's not really helping me prepare for finishers. Like that doesn't make sense. But then like if I'm preparing for an IBJJF, then I'm going to read all the rules in the rule book and I'm going to like cater my jiu-jitsu to the point scoring while also like still trying to finish the match with a submission. That's always the goal. But I'm going to make sure I understand how points are scored. You know what I'm talking about?
Right, for sure. Yeah. For sure. Yeah, I when I read the IBJJF rule book, it's more to think like, okay, am I automatically disqualified for touching the person's foot in this way, or do I have to touch it this way, or what do I have to do? But it seems like you have a very mental approach to how you come into these events. Like you have a very set way that you want to approach each match.
Yeah, I don't want to like go out there and be like, oh, I lost because I didn't know the rules. That's such a stupid excuse. Anybody that like goes out there and makes that excuse, they should feel like that's ridiculous. Like, why didn't you read the rules?
I agree.
What? Common sense.
I agree. People who were asking you for seminars, is there anything that people can look forward to seeing you in seminars?
I have like an online seminar coming up, but that's about it. I think it's going to be streamed on like thedojo.com or something. That's pretty much it right now. Huh?
When is that?
April 23rd. It's a Saturday.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So it's coming up pretty soon.
Yeah.
Cool. What are you going over in the seminar? Or you don't know
yet? I
don't
know yet. I haven't planned it. I'll plan it a couple days before.
I was hoping for some like breaking news, you know, you can give me the scoop.
Nope. Sorry.
No worries. I appreciate you said that. I appreciate you coming on and talking to me a little bit. I really like watching you compete. I think you're a fun competitor to watch. So, like I said, I scooped you now before you have a million followers on Instagram and you don't see my DMs anymore. But if people aren't already following you, where can they see more of you?
They can follow me at Sophia Cassella BJJ on Instagram. I think that's it. I think that's all the social media I do.
Yeah. I'll put the link to it in the description below too, so people can hopefully just click on that and check your page out. Sophia, thank you so much for coming on. I really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
Big thank you to Sophia Cassella for coming on the show and talking with me. I put all of the links you need down in the description. Make sure you give Sophia a follow. If you like this video, which you've made it this far, so either you are hate watching it or you enjoyed it. Either way, why not hit that thumbs up button and subscribe to the channel? You can also watch one of these videos next, and I will see you all in the next episode.